One of the drugs at the center of the ongoing opioid crisis is the prescription painkiller OxyContin. The drug's manufacturer, Purdue Pharma, controlled by the wealthy Sackler family, began selling OxyContin in 1996. Now, there are new revelations about how the company, and specifically family members, pushed the marketing and sales of the drug. It is part of a case the state of Massachusetts has brought against Purdue Pharma, alleging the company and its executives misled prescribers and patients about OxyContin's dangers. This weekend, I spoke with Patrick Radden Keefe, a staff writer for The New Yorker who's been covering the OxyContin story for years, about new details being revealed in that case.
Purdue Pharma has long told a story, which is essentially that the Sackler family, which owns the company, has a real arm's length relationship, is not actually all that involved. And the Sacklers have developed this reputation as great patrons of the arts and universities who never really have to talk about the family business, which is the source of all their wealth. What's fascinating about this filing in Massachusetts is that you have hundreds of pages of documentation from inside the company showing very, very active involvement from multiple members of the family who were members of the board, but not members of the board who are at some distance, mm-hmm. members of the board who are very, very actively directing Purdue Pharma in pushing OxyContin even after this epic public health crisis that we're all experiencing now.
Give us an example.
Well, so Richard Sackler, who's really the most active of these various family members, who's the son of one of the founders of the company, one of the three brothers who originally took it over, would regularly be asking for sales reports. He would be coaching people on how they should go out and push OxyContin to doctors. When you started having people dying of overdoses, he is very involved in emails saying, look, the way we're going to spin this is that it's about drug addicts. These people are criminals. This is not our problem.
Blaming the victims.
Blaming the victims, absolutely. And he really comes across in email after email after email in these various accounts as somebody who was almost obsessed with the sales of the drug, to a point where you get to a stage just a few years ago where sales of OxyContin start to level off. And there's an obvious reason for that, which is that doctors have woken up to the fact that this drug is killing people and opioids are killing people. We now have, you know, some 200,000 people who've died in opioid-related deaths in the last few decades. And so sales are leveling off, and this clearly drives him nuts. And he's saying, you know, we need to keep pushing. We want bigger doses of the drug for longer periods of time, which is exactly what anybody who's looking at this soberly will tell you is a recipe for addiction and a dangerous state of affairs.
And were there experts that they had that were doing this kind of prescribing?
Well, they had the part of the story of the Sackler family, and part of the reason that even though OxyContin is just one of many opioids, it was really the one that sparked the opioid crisis, is that this is a company that, when it first introduced the drug, very consciously set out to change the minds of doctors. The doctors up to that point had been reluctant to prescribe strong opioids for pain conditions that weren't sort of end of life, palliative care, cancer treatment.
They didn't even want this to be a prescription drug at one point, right?
Well, right. So you actually have a point where it was going to be a prescription drug here, but they were looking to expand internationally, and the Sacklers start wondering, well, could we have this be a non-controlled substance? So like aspirin, you walk into CVS and just buy it over the counter. And there's a back and forth in these documents between Richard Sackler and the inventor of OxyContin. The inventor of the drug says, I think it would be pretty dangerous. That would be a bad idea. And Richard Sackler says, yeah, but what would it do to our bottom line? What would it do to the number of sales we could get?
Give us a scale of how bad the crisis got, how bad the prescriptions got.
Well, you get to a point where you have thousands of people dying, really left and right, in various regions across the United States. And it's actually the crisis at this point, part of what's interesting about it, is that it's everywhere, is that, you know, almost any American will know people. It doesn't discriminate in terms of class, race, geography. And part of what was striking to me about this Massachusetts filing is that you have all this internal documentation that suggests that even in the face of this knowledge, the Sackler family is still pushing and wondering, you know, how can we get out there? How can we be selling more? Why are sales slowing down? And so they're fully aware of the crisis. They're fully aware of the huge, I mean, just astonishing human toll.
So these aren't emails from 10, 15 years ago. This is just in the last few years.
No, this is what was most striking. So in 2007, Purdue Pharma actually pled guilty to criminal charges of misbranding, essentially deceiving people about the dangers of the drug. Three executives pled guilty. The company paid a $600 million fine. And one of the big interesting questions has been, all right, well, if that was the turning point, was that when they kind of got wise? Was that when they realized, oh boy, okay, we may have transgressed a little bit in those early days, but now we know what's going on. And we now have this documentation showing that not just in 2008, 2009, but in 2016, 2017, when the country is reeling from this epidemic, inside Purdue Pharma, they're still thinking, how can we push this drug?
There were also documents in here, or I should say there were parts of the filing that included them trying to have an influence on both academia and hospitals. How did they do this?
Well, this has been part of the strategy for the company. I should say not just Purdue, but many companies. Purdue really has excelled at it, and the Sacklers have. In terms of first of all, influencing doctors, all right? So there's all kinds of relationships they have with doctors. They realized early on that a doctor is more likely to prescribe a new drug if it's another doctor recommending it. I thought it was almost like putting an athlete on a box of Wheaties, right? Mm-hmm. You listen to the people you trust, your peers. So they started paying doctors. They, you know, funded research. So you get this crazy situation in which you're a physician and I'm a physician and I come to you to tell you about this new drug. I'm paid by the drug company. I show you a study that's been done about the drug, which was also paid for by the drug company. We have this conversation over an expensive steak dinner at a nice resort in Florida, and we're all, you know, getting sent there by the drug company. One of the statistics in this filing is that Purdue's budget just for food bought for physicians who prescribe opioids every year was $9 million a year.
That's a lot of nice steak dinners. What happens next? Because if the company has been sued once, what the AG is filing and the evidence that she's laying out, what does that do to other lawsuits that might be in play?
There are dozens and dozens of lawsuits right now ongoing across the country. More than half of the states in the United States are suing Purdue Pharma. And so it's unclear where these are going to go. Some people think there will ultimately be a big settlement along the lines that there were with the tobacco companies back in the 1990s. I think the interesting thing for the Sackler family is that what this Massachusetts case has done is kind of pierced the corporate veil. It's no longer just Purdue Pharma and the Sacklers are somehow at a distance. Now the Sacklers have all been named. And it does seem that there may be some real liability on the parts of these individuals who were clearly directing the company. So if I were them, I'd be worried. I think you're going to see more lawsuits. You will ultimately see some sort of big settlement. And the really interesting case now is that for decades, part of the reason the Sacklers were able to kind of burnish their own reputation was by giving huge amounts of money to elite cultural institutions, to museums like the Guggenheim, to universities like Yale. So at what point do these institutions start saying no to that money and potentially taking the Sackler name off of their various institutes and buildings?
All right. Patrick Radden Keefe of The New Yorker. Thanks so much.
Thank you.